like, that's all.
What motivated you to write it?
Well, I wanted to write a book. What motivated me to write this particular book or any book?
Well, both. Let's start with, you know, basic motivation. What makes a young attractive girl decide suddenly that she's going to stop working for Fawcett or Gold Medal or wherever you were working?
Gold Fawcett.
And sit down and write yourself a book.
And were you working for them at the time that you wrote the book?
No, I quit.
Short time before, or?
Well, I quit because I didn't want to work anymore, and then I thought as long as I was free, I would write a book. You want me to give you a real egghead answer? You won't laugh while
I
really wrote this book?
No, I don't want an egghead answer. I want a real answer because I know.
Right. I mean, you can't. How can you sit here,
you know,
at a party or anywhere, and, you know, in a dress like this and give an egghead answer? But I'll tell you the truth.
Let me tell you something. You know, and I know, that it is extremely difficult, extremely lonely, and extremely exacting to write a book.
Yes.
Yes. And you lived in New York City, and you were a single girl, and presumably all these predatory wolves were surrounding you, but you preferred to stay home and work. Why?
Well, I'll tell you. This is the first time I've ever said anything this egghead, and I'm waiting for you to laugh, but it's true, and I'll be very brave. I think that the only way that a person, a human being, can get a sense of identity is through doing something, and something which is for somebody else. And I wrote this book, really, for girls like April in the book, who were going to go through this kind of thing in New York, and for girls who had gone through this kind of thing. And the great tragedy is that these girls just think they're the only one. They think that, you know, I'm alone and I can't tell anybody because it's so awful and I have this problem. And it was so that if even one girl would read it and would say, I now realize that somebody knows about my problems and my life. And from doing this, I got a sense of importance, which I had to get
which
from doing
became,
something.
Certainly. Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't to become important. I didn't do it so that I would become a famous writer of a bestseller and become important that way. Because that's another thing. And if you don't become successful for something that you're proud of, it's no good. I mean, at least for me it isn't, because I would just feel like I was going through false pretenses.
Well, if the story comes out with any tinge of the soap opera about it, it is maybe only because, or partly because there are so many almost everyone in the, all of your characters are involved in some kind of extramarital or premarital or some kind of problem relationship. And maybe it's the fact that I don't think there was a girl, at least not in the movie, there wasn't a girl in the picture that had more than four or five lines that didn't have some pretty big problems with
pretty
men.
Pretty perfect problem.
Their problems were all men,
and all the men seemed to be...
All
I can say is I think life is one big soap opera, and to illustrate it to you, the next time you ever tell a girl you love her, stop and say, how would this look on the printed page? I guarantee you, you'll stop in the middle of the sentence and say, let's have a drink and forget it.
I surrender.
You had a very nice theme song, you know, Best of Everything.
Yeah, you mean in the picture?
In the picture.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I sort of thought Soap Gets in Your Eyes might have
been I didn't write the song, and I think it's very pretty.
I do too.
With a full Johnny Mathis
version.
I think
it's going to be a very successful picture.
Mm.
I'm
it already
certain it's
is.
Going to be. Yes.
It should be explained, Rona, that Speck is expressing here a little, well, we at Playboy have a very, see, we feel that some of the problems of the, if maybe not the world, but of America at least, are an over-feminization. And we have a somewhat different notion about the whole thing. And
excuse me, Hef. Ella Fitzgerald just came in.
Ah, wonderful. Excuse me just a minute. Ella is here, and we'll be back with her in just a matter of moments. It's great having you with us, Ella. A real pleasure, as always. And I've got a little surprise for you that I think you're going to get a kick out of. This summer, Playboy threw a jazz festival. It was the biggest and, according to the critics, the best thing of its kind ever put together. And certainly without any question, the high point of the entire weekend for us and everybody there was Ella's performance. Now, we've got a little track of that here. And Downbeat called this the very best thing that Ella has ever done. Imagine the very best of Ella, they said, and double it. And you're going to get a chance to hear that now. Ella's never heard it. We brought it up as a surprise. It's not available commercially, but it's something pretty special. Let's listen to it. ¶¶
Cause people want what I'm singing. Believe it or not, it's still Did you ever see a dream walking? Well, I did. Tisket and tasket, I lost my yellow basket. Having a heat wave, tropical heat wave. We didn't do it. I guess I'd better quit while I'm ahead with
moments in jazz, and a wonderful moment for all of us, too.
Thank you, Hef.
I wonder, the group is here, and I wonder if you'd sing a song for us.
Well, we can try. Do something for you.
Thank you.
Okay. We do but enough for me. Okay. This is informal, right? But not